two, and one. Okay, so we are in lesson six of unit six, and today we're gonna be exploring a which one does not belong for your invitation to the math. So I want you to see here on the board, I wrote four equations. And you are gonna choose which one you think does not belong, and you have to be able to justify your reasoning. So I'm gonna give you about 30 to 45 seconds of think time. Thank you for joining me at the Math Reflective. My name is Kathy Dixon, and I'm a sixth grade teacher in Illinois. And I'm so glad that you decided to click on this video. So today we're gonna talk about an instructional routine called Which One Doesn't Belong. And I wanna talk to you today about it, tell you how to do it, why to do it, and I'm gonna reflect on an activity that I did with my sixth grade advanced math students. And the reason, one of the reasons I'm so sold on using this resource is the equity. I know that's a big word in education right now, is providing access and equity. And I have to admit, I recently went to the National Council of Teaching Mathematics conference because I wanted to know more about what does it mean for a math teacher to provide equitable practices? What does that look like in the classroom? There's an activity at the beginning that draws every learner in. No matter what, everyone can be successful. And it starts out with a teacher presenting four different problems or pictures, sometimes it's pictures of patterns, and students get quiet think time. So that's always important to have individual think time to think about an answer. And after think time, the students can then raise their hand and tell which one they think doesn't belong. Now, the really cool thing about this routine is no matter what the student says, they could pick the first, second, third, or fourth picture or problem. Sometimes we refer to them as A, B, C, and D. They could pick any of those, and as long as they justify their reasoning and they have an answer that makes sense, they're correct, which is why it's so awesome. It can even be something that's the way the expression looks or the pattern looks. It doesn't have to be so deep and mathematical, and that's why it has open access for everybody. So the which one does not belong that we were doing was four different equations, and they had to choose which one did not fit with the others and have a reason why. But it's really cool what ended up happening in the classroom because my students kind of took off with this. I'm finding that in this inquiry-based resource, I have to kind of sit back a lot more than I'm used to. I definitely was more of a direct teaching, note-taking teacher before, and I've had to really let go and let the students just take the learning where it's supposed to be. And they usually hit all the targets and things that I want them to hit through this process. Of course, I have to scaffold and support along the way. Another reason why I love this instructional routine is because it definitely brings into play a lot of the mathematical practices. Students are critiquing the reasoning of others, they're defending their own reasoning, they're using precision, you're encouraging them to use mathematical language and vocabulary. Students are generalizing and seeing patterns in the thinking. You'll definitely notice that when you look at the clip that I have of my students doing this routine. So after the individual think time, I just open it up for discussion. Okay, who thinks that problem A or equation A did not belong and why? And then I start to call on students and they can give me their reasons. And another important part of the routine is that you're writing all these down to make it visible and for it to be on display for the whole class to see because everyone's learning from each other. Remember, any of them, as long as you justify your answer, could be correct. Okay, think time. Okay, let's start with A. Actually raise your hands if you thought this equation did not belong with the others. Equation A, raise your hand. Six, about six people. Okay, I'm gonna start with Will. Can you give me a reason why this particular one does not belong with the others?
It's the only one with parentheses.
Okay, only one with parentheses, and I'll just use the parentheses symbol. Excellent. Anybody else have another idea for why equation A does not belong with the rest? Okay, I can, oh, go ahead.
It's not what it shows, but I just
thought of one. Oh, good.
It's the only one that's adding something to X instead of multiplying.
Okay, it's the only one, is this one adding something to X?
Yeah.
No. Yeah, but
no.
It's also multiplying.
Okay, so you said equation A is adding something to X and it's the only one that's not also multiplying. Does anyone have a response to that? What do you think, Stephanie?
Okay, well, can you repeat the...
Okay, I'll say what I think that he said. He said this one is the only one that's not multiplying by x, it's just adding something to x.
Okay.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, well, it's adding something to x, but it's also multiplying with x.
Okay, so you said it's adding something to x and multiplying something by x. Can you elaborate?
Okay, so it's x plus 3 and equals something, and then 4 times the something equals 9, but x.
Oh, you're saying this is multiplication?
Yes, when 3 is added into x.
When 3 is added into that, you're then multiplying that.
Yeah.
What did you want to add to that, Lily?
Well, it doesn't show the multiplication symbol, but you're still multiplying.
Okay, so you're saying it doesn't show the multiplication symbol,
yeah,
but you're still multiplying. Mm-hmm. How do we know we're multiplying?
Because when you put a number and parentheses together, that represents multiplication.
Awesome. When you put a number next to parentheses, that implies multiplication. That's that next to notation. We need to celebrate and honor everyone's contribution there. 1, 2, 3. Let's go on to B. Who, raise your hand if you thought equation B did not belong with the others. Okay, about 4 of you. All right. Bhavan, can you tell me why B does not belong?
I think it's because it's the only one where you multiply first before you add.
Okay, so you're saying you multiply first before you add.
Yeah.
But what you're saying is the first part of the problem shows multiplication?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to put that first part shows multiplication. Okay, what else about this one? Who has a different reason why B does not belong? Taryn? Okay, so only one that shows a mult. I'm going to put a mult for symbol. For multiplication, I just put mult. And that is the dot, right? The other ones use next to notation. Excellent. Okay, did you have another one?
Yeah.
For that one? Okay, go ahead for B.
It's kind of the same in terms, but I thought that it's the only one with x by itself, which is not smooth with another number or in parentheses.
Okay, so you're kind of restating what she said, but in a different way. So x is not in parentheses or next to a number. And that number we call a coefficient. Coefficient. Okay, I think we're going to move on. Do you have another one for that one?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's the only one that has, like, that shows two symbols.
Okay, it's the only one that shows two. Can we be more specific? Isn't the equation kind of a symbol too? The equal sign? Can we, I'm going to tell you what they're called. They're actually called operators because they show us operations. So I'm going to say operators. Okay, we're going to move on to equation C. 4 plus 3x equals 9. Raise your hand if you thought equation C does not belong with the rest. Okay, a few of you. Yes, Victoria.
I think it doesn't belong because I actually tried to solve it, and I think it's the only one with a positive answer.
Wow. She thinks it's the only one with a positive answer. I want you to spend 10 seconds and turn and talk at your table and discuss this. Okay, time's up.
Okay.
What'd you guys come up with? She said, Victoria said, that this is the only equation that would have a positive value for x. What do you think, Victor? Victoria is correct. It is the only one that has a positive solution for x.
What? Wait.
Do you need to think about that more? X is going to equal negative 3/4 for A. So that's why we were talking about, if we went through these other examples, you would see they would be negative solutions for x. And now we're going to move on to our next activity where you're going to have to read a situation or a story and find out which tape diagram matches. Okay, we're going to continue our conversation. Okay. Many times there's one, two, three or more things that I don't even think about and the students notice. Of course, I have the teacher guide that I'm looking at. And sometimes I see certain things that I don't know that the kids will come up with, but they seem to always come up with all of them and even more, which is surprising and delightful. As you can see from that clip, I was continuing to question students as I felt the need to. So when I didn't feel I was eliciting the exact response I needed, I was asking for some elaboration. The other thing that I introduced was talking about the word operators, because one student was talking about the multiplication sign being the only symbol in that equation. I wanted to point out that an equal sign is also a symbol, so maybe we need to be more precise with our language and call it an operator symbol. So the students probably had never heard that before. One other thing that you notice I did a lot was to restate my students' thinking. Well, one reason I did that is because the students weren't on camera and I wanted to make sure that the video picked up on it. But another thing was, or a reason was, is I just wanted them to hear what they were saying. I wanted to make sure that I understood if I needed to extend or clarify their thinking. Also, it gives students another opportunity to hear their thoughts and maybe build on it or perhaps want to critique the reasoning of others. I also made these ABCD cards to make it easier. If there was a multiple choice or if there were four selections, I could label them ABCD and then just have the students, I do a pull of the class routine where they just all hold up the letter of the one that they think doesn't belong. That's really interesting because then you can kind of tally on the board how many said each of the choices and have a discussion and further your learning with that. I think my favorite moment was when Victoria threw that one nugget out where she said that she felt that C was the only one that had a positive solution. And you could tell there was just like a little bit of a buzz in the room. So I'm glad that I was able to think about that cue and then give students some time to reflect and talk about that. And you could hear the excitement in the room. It kind of stumped some of them and they wanted to think about that. I thought it was funny how I kept trying to move on and my students kept raising their hand and they had more ideas. So it's very important as a teacher, I learned from that, that I need to give more wait time. I'm kind of hyper, I have a fast personality, a fast talker, so I really need to work on slowing down and giving that proper wait time, especially for students that take a little bit longer to think. Well, thank you for watching this video. Please hit the like button and subscribe to my channel, The Math Reflective. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram. Stay tuned for more videos and more fun diving into math, thinking about our teaching, and how we can increase student and our own professional potential. Are you ready for more?